in the Yarra Valley now, which is fantastic. And what makes the valley so special to grow wine in is basically, we'll grow grapes for the wine, is the temperature here. The average temperature during this summer is actually a pretty cool 24 degrees. During winter, look at that cold. We've had a couple of days just on zero, but the average winter temperature here is roughly around 6 to 9 degrees. So, and then in between the autumn and spring, they can differ anywhere between 15 to 20. So it's a perfect climate to grow grapes just for the wine, which is fantastic. There's a lot of cider places out here and quite a few produce farms as well. And what I like to do at the start of, well, pretty much every tour is a acknowledgement of country. And we are still in the Wurundjeri people's land, and a acknowledgement of country is acknowledging the past, the present, and the become of those Wurundjeri people, and saying thanks for letting us experience their land as once they did thousands of years ago. Look, at a minimum, they were here 60,000 years ago. And in some spots in the middle of Australia, they were here over 110,000 years ago. So they were the very first true hunter and gatherers. They were living off the land before we knew how to walk. So it's quite amazing. There's about 5 different countries in Victoria of the Aboriginal nations, which is pretty special. But I feel like it gives a little bit of good luck at every point, every day that I do it. And it's just one way we can show reconciliation, one road to reconciliation. But it's a beautiful area out here. I love the valley. Like I mentioned, it's up there with one of the best regions in Australia. And in fact, we're going to be driving past one of the oldest, I would say, vineyards in Victoria, that's for sure. There's one up here, it's actually about as old as 1838. And essentially, look, Melbourne was settled in 1832 by John Batman. And it was only for a few more years that they ventured up the river more to see how far they could get. And they reached up here and they thought, this is perfect. We'll start growing some wine out here. And then the region itself, it got so big during the between the 1850s and 1860s through that gold rush. Warburton Goldfields is not too far from here, and so if you docked in Melbourne, you would actually have to walk through the valley region to get to the gold fields. And then the people that found gold, well, they were on their way back, and they were putting a lot of money through this region right here. And Yering Station on our right hand side benefited the most through the gold rush era. So Yering Station is the oldest vineyard in Victoria, and so this is it on our right hand side. And then by about the 1880s, 1890s, this region through here was winning worldwide awards, and basically it was at the top of the food chain. The Yarra Valley really was. And then by about the stayed there till about the 1920s, 1930s, when the Great Depression unfortunately hit here in Australia, and basically a lot of the vineyards that were opened up, they actually had to shut down. They cut down all their vines, and they turned their land into farmland. Essentially, they felt they needed livestock more than what they needed wine. And Yering Station was lucky enough that it was big enough to still have a row of vines, but they turned most of it into a basically a livestock yard. And then it slowly started getting back up on its feet, the Yarra Valley. By about the 1960s, there was a few extra vineyards getting opened up, more vines were getting planted. And then by about the 1980s, 1990s, and they were back up the top. And there was a lot more wine regions produced around Australia, but Yarra Valley has always been the one most known about. Right here is the Yarra River, right here. Look, as the crow flies to Melbourne, it's roughly around anywhere between 50 to 65 kilometres away. Now, as the river runs, it's close to around 213 kilometres long, weaving its way down through to Melbourne CBD, and then it runs all the way out to Port Phillip Bay. And sometimes when we do get a lot of rain here in Melbourne, it can make Port Phillip Bay really, really dirty, given that there's a lot of dirt that's come from the mountains up here and flushing out onto the bay out there. The Green Hotel, this is a beautiful, beautiful pub here in the Yarra Valley, one of the oldest pubs in this region. And at these joints, at the Green Hotel, you can get a pot and parma. Has anyone had a parma before? A chicken parmigiana? Yeah. A couple of people, yes. For those that haven't, it is a crumbed breast fillet with a bit of tomato paste, bit of ham on top, and then it has melted cheese served with the side of chips and salad. I don't know about you guys, but I'm salivating at the thought of it. It is like an iconic feed here in Melbourne. In fact, in Australia, it's pretty iconic, but in Melbourne, we've perfected it here. And basically, all you have to do, if you haven't had one, I'm going to teach you guys how to order one, okay? So all you have to do is go to the pub. Well, we chuck hotel on the end of names, just to make it sound a little bit more fancier, but still a bogan pub. So you're going to find a couple of Aussie larrikins in there, like myself, on a Saturday afternoon, cheering some bloke ride a pony. So, what you have to do is walk up to the bar, and all you have to say is, "G'day, mate, pot and parma, please." And a pot is a delicious tasting frothy, a nice beer, or you can have a wine with it, or you can have a lemonade. I don't really care. And then the parma is the chicken parmigiana, all right? And then the waiter or the waitress will turn around and say, "No worries, coming right up," all right? So, look, guys, on three, we're going to practice that, because I want you guys to absolutely nail this. So on three, we're going to practice, "G'day, mate, pot and parma, please." All right, here we go, legends. One, two, three. "G'day, mate, pot and parma, please." Hey, no worries, coming right up. So that's just a natural reaction. So us Aussies have when we hear those words. So please make sure you go and try a chicken parmigiana. You will not regret it, that's for sure. But legends, we are not too far away from Balgowny, our very first winery, our first stop. What a way to kick off the tour. And Balgowny, well, we're known. I briefly mentioned about a sparkling Shiraz. These guys are known for their sparkling Shiraz here. You don't think bubbles should go well with a red, but then somehow it does. It's absolutely unbelievable. Unfortunately, during the pandemic, Yarra Valley copped it the most. They had no one come down getting the buying their wines and whatnot, and then they slowly started opening back up. And Balgowny was hit with a double whammy. They actually had a fire break out in their restaurant and destroy a bit of the resort as well. Their vines were untouched, but it was a big blow for Balgowny after not having anyone in the region for 2 years, and then basically having a fire rip through. So a lot of the locals, they had to get around and support Balgowny, and they got them back up on their feet. And now it is a five-star resort that they've got. The building and the kitchen is unbelievable, and the views of the vineyard is pretty incredible. So it's good to see they're back up on their feet, and basically it's beautiful tasting. You'll take a stop up here. So once you do the tasting, you can walk through the restaurant and come out on this balcony up here. Oh my God, guys, is that a kangaroo? Once you do the tasting, you want to head out onto that balcony there, and you can get some beautiful photos of looking into the valley, which is good. But what we're going to do, guys, is it's pretty much 10 o'clock. We'll aim to be back at the bus at 10:45, I reckon. So it gives us a good...
Farmers just in Bendigo, White Shiraz. All of our wines are actually made in Bendigo. Stuart Anderson, I think is what's his name. Hence the name Balgowny, because obviously I think he must have come from around that area. Please help yourselves to a glass.
Can you get me?
Yeah.
what I will do, come around.
I'll be back, Shaka. Happy birthday to me.
Happy birthday to you.
Where are we all from?
I mean, we're obviously not all from Australia.
We're from
Malaysia, yeah.
We're from the Philippines.
Philippines, yeah. We've had a few people from the Philippines through in recent weeks. You're welcome. So you must have been picked up at what time?
Eight.
Really, that took that long to get out here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No,
we were
10 to 9. I had a good run this morning.
Alcoholic. Hey guys, Katrina. 10 o'clock pa lang. Nag-away na siya. Sparkling Shiraz. It's party time. Ang posh ng birthday ko. May paway. Party.
Known for making sweet wines per se. Well, about the sweetest wine we make would either be the sparkling Shiraz.
Which is, guys, hindi ko mapigilan si Katrina. Inom siya ng inom.
Oh, grabe.
That's 13 grams. This is 9, this is 18 grams. Sparkling Shiraz, the last one you had, was 19 grams.
Ganda. Kaya hindi nila mag-market. Yes. Picture siya dyan.
Apples and zucchini, really.
Apat na siya. Hindi ganun yung kamamas namin.
Ay, hindi talaga sparkles.
Kasama siya. Ayan siya mag-inspect. Cheese. Personing. Thanks, Parker.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. We are having our second batch of alcohol today. Four Pillars Gin Paddle Tasting. Yeah, because there is a paddle like that, then they put different gin. Yeah, it's Four Pillars.
But while we're waiting here, I'll just give you a brief intro. Yes. So we've got two spaces. We started distilling in 2013. We got this space in 2015. So this is the original distillery. It's where we made all the production. This is a new space that we opened April 2022. This is specifically a bar. So we say we learned the theory over on that side. That's where we do the tastings. And over on this side, this is where we sit down for a drink. So with the package that you guys have, you're going to get our most popular drink option, which is a gin and tonic paddle. You get four mini gins and a bottle of tonic. Now, you can have a different mixer if you'd like, if tonic is not your thing. Just let your friendly waitstaff know, and we can put another mixer on there for you.
Beautiful.
Hibiki.
Everywhere is gin.
Yeah, no, it's just very
small. Hey, Mago, so you're going. This is magandang marketing. It's a big group. Saan natin si Perth? Dito tayo.
If you do want it, we'll substitute that for you as well. Alright? I'm not showing a bad face for that reason, but... so, have a little think off any one of those mixtures that you do want with your paddles, and I'll come around and take your orders for that as well. And I'll grab you some glasses. Now, if you do want to purchase any 700 or 500 ml bottles of gin today, you do get $10 off all 500 or 700 ml bottles. Alright, so just head up to the retail area once you're finishing here, and let whoever is around there, which would probably be myself, that you guys just did a paddle. If I'm not there, that you did a paddle, and you get $10 off all the large bottles.
Okay.
Alright, so I'm going to grab you some glasses and I'll be back to this.
The rare dry gin. So that's our classic gin at 41.8% alcohol. Mm-hmm. It's the first gin we've ever made. It just turned 10 years old in December, so still not old yet, old enough to drink yet. But you know, it serves its purpose. We literally use 9 base botanicals in the making of each of our gins, measured at different quantities depending on what gin that we're making. The main canvas of our gin or botanical realm is all used with juniper berries, which is 60 to 70% of what we use is juniper berries. The other main botanical that is used is coriander seeds. We add some cardamom pods in there as one of our little spices. Two native Australian botanicals, lemon myrtle, which produces roughly around 6 to 8 times more citral oils than any other citrus on the face of the earth. Why not use that in enhancing that citral flavor within the gins? There's also Tasmanian pepperberry leaf as well. We've added a little bit of star anise. Well, I hate star anise because you know you had one bad night of black sambuca and you realize.
Very true.
So we use star anise as our added sweetener. There's no sugar added to it. We also add a little bit of cassia bark, which is like the cousin of cinnamon. And then we finish off with some lavender, as well as angelica root, which is a fixed leaf that binds the flavors and the fragrance of everything together. Now, as our main citrus, because we like to, you know, think about ourselves being a citral forward distillery, we use roughly around 12 to 15 kilos of fresh organic oranges, depending on what still we're using. Feel free to have a look next door when you're leaving as well at the stills through the window. You can see it all. Second gin in the middle, Navy Strength, the strongest, 58.8% alcohol. Garnished with coffee, lime leaf, and ginger. Now, to be classed as a Navy Strength gin, over proof or whatever it's called around the world, it has to be about 57% alcohol. With those 9 base botanicals, we have changed our stuff a little bit by adding a few extra little stuff to it, such as the 5 kilos of oranges, 7 kilos of finger limes. We've added some dehydrated turmeric to it as well. And then 2 kilos of fresh cut ginger from Queensland. Is there anyone from Queensland here today?
Yeah.
Thank you for the gingers. We've also went ahead and created our third gin, which is our Bloody Shiraz gin. Now, the Bloody Shiraz gin is a sweeter one. I like to call it adult Ribena. Scotty likes to call it something else. With the Bloody Shiraz gin, it's literally taking our classic rare dry gin at 93% alcohol. We submerge fresh Shiraz grape from around the Yarra Valley inside of those inside of the gin for 8 weeks. So there's no barrel aging that takes place, there's no fermentation, just grape juice bleeding out into gins for 8 weeks. At the end of that 8 weeks, we compress those grapes, which release a lot more of that color, a lot more of that sweetness. Drops down to roughly around 23% alcohol, which is way sweet, too thick like a liqueur. So we add some more gin to it to build that alcohol content up to 37.8% alcohol. Because as Australia do say by law, to be classed as a gin, it has to be about 37% alcohol. The extra one that Scotty's putting around is our Go-To gin. So Go-To is a skincare brand with Zoe Foster Blake. They look after the outside, we look after the inside. That sounded way better in my head. Now, that one has a little bit of a sweeter undertone because we use a little bit of a native peach, which is the kumquats. We also add a little bit of green apple. A little bit of spicy we'll get from that, from the pepper berry that is also used in there, or peppercorns. With some turmeric and so forth. So I like to say, if you've had a fresh yuzu gin and a Navy Strength gin, it's like both of those come together, had a baby, and we call it Go-To. Yes. So have a little sip of each first before you actually add your tonic or your lemonade to your gin. You want to start with your rare dry, you want to second Navy, go with the Go-To third, and finish off on a sweeter note with the Bloody Shiraz last as well. With the level of tonic that you add to it, I would say go up to half in the glass just so you don't lose the flavor of that. And especially if you're using tonic, because it's a bit more sweeter, I would say use less than you would if you're using tonic as well. But definitely have a little taste of it first before you add any mixtures to it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I might have to. Want to see your reaction?
Sweet.
Can you drink?
Number one.
Yeah. Okay, sip.
Say that first.
It's strong. It's strong, but yeah, take a little sip. Smell the flavor.
Are you ready?
Smells like tequila.
Yes, right.
Really strong flavor. Yeah, oh yeah, that navy one will be strong.
Whoa!
Whoa! Let's try with the Tony there.
How much?
You said that's the middle.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it.
Why not?
Yeah.
Do you like
ginger? No.
Kain na tayo.
Yeah.
Pero, may wine pa rin.
Yeah. Yung mga lupain natin, Freshel and MM, bibili tayo dito na 100 square meter. May ano, BC. Rockford Cellar.
Oh.
Wait. Tabi tayo. Yeah.
Okay guys, pangatlong alak na natin for today.
Pangatlong estate.
Pinapipili lang kami kung anong estate yung bibili natin.
Sabihin ng boy.
Goes down well, easy to drink. Exactly what you want on a Monday.
If you have a big weekend, it might be a struggle to go down. Not what you want on this one. You probably like this one. It's not full oak, but if you were to determine it between oak and buttery, it's on the oakier side. What I find with oakier Chardonnays is the flavours tend to be a little bit more segregated, whereas we find the buttery ones, they kind of more flavoured, and that's what, yeah, blends, and that's what kind of gives it that smooth butter flavour. But I'm a big fan of the Chardonnay. I'm usually not a white drinker, but... And it's just the estate range as well, so... But I actually, out of all the Chardonnays we have here, this is the estate range, and then there's all the single vineyards. I actually prefer this over the single vineyard one. But again, I'm not a Chardy drinker, I'm a red drinker, so... But yeah, let me know how you go.
So what do you mean by estate versus single
vineyard? So, estate range is basically... all the grapes, all the Chardonnay grapes, it's the shittier grapes, and they're all just blended together, so they're like the dodgy grapes. It's like the so it's like that, where the single vineyards are like the best of the best, and then they're sometimes blended with the leaves and the stalks and stems and all that, because that produces more flavour, so you get that full body kind of flavour. So that's really good.
This is a more earthier, mushroomier Pinot rather than a light, fruity one. Being a Pinot, it's still very light and fruity, but it just is a bit more grounded from the other ones. A lot of people that like the fruity ones, I will compare them, they actually prefer this over the fruity one.
So if you turn over to the reds and rose page, I think it's the second one down.
She'll explain it.
Okay. If I drink whites, I'm more of a Pinot Gris Riesling person rather than a classic Sav Chardonnay. So those of you who've got that, I hope you enjoy it because I absolutely love it. And those who have the red, it's just the estate Syrah. So you'll find it's very peppery on the mouth.
Estate.
So those who are familiar with the wine Pepper Jack, it's very, very similar to that. Beautiful with like a steak or a rose or anything. So probably my favorite brand for the estate range is Syrah.
Sure.
I'll come back in a couple of minutes.
Country? Sa tropical country? Sa tropical country?
Sabi sino meron eh.
Ah, meron daw. Pero parang 1% only. Oh my, it's a lot. It's too many. Anything? Makita, dito.
Are you watching the
Kung
Fu Kung Fu Kung Fu? And they're not even on Kung Fu. What's
an Kung
Fu? From Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Oh.
These are all skinny.
Australian cocoa, grown specifically in the Daintree Rainforest. Wherever cocoa is grown, will take on slightly different characteristics. So this one has a real, it's almost licorice-y taste that comes through on this one. Now Australia, we are very small fry in the world of cocoa and chocolate. We're like 1% of cocoa production. So it's almost like just a little token plantation that we have. The main areas are going to be Indonesia, South America, and Africa is the biggest producers of cocoa in the world. Now, we call it the cocoa belt. What that really means is close to the equator, because that is where it is warmest and most tropical. All right. So that is the Australian chocolate cocoa. We are going to now go in. So Ghana is in Africa and is the biggest producers of cocoa in the world. This is a 72% cocoa though. So obviously a lot darker, but a completely different taste. Not too bitter though. Some of our single origins out there where they're growing specifically in different regions are very bitter, like the Ecuador. I can hardly, it's too much. The Australian dark is nice, and yeah, this one is not too bad. So Ghana, the biggest producers of cocoa. However, they do.
Ah, yeah. Yeah.
Parehas ba ito sa diet?
Yeah. I think
o iba
that's
pa sila?
Diet. Or lime. Lemon.
Lime yung tawag nila.
Check out, but yeah, thank you so much today. A guide is only as good as his guest. You guys have been phenomenal, so thank you very much. What I'll do, I've got some cards I'll hand out on the back of them. There's a little QR code. You can leave us a review if you like. You can write things like, oh, Red was the worst singer ever. Red had the worst jokes ever. Or you can write things like, Red should be a comedian. Red should be an actor. Red should be on TV. You know, just stuff like that, all right? And I believe the Wi-Fi actually works best when you're leaving a 5-star review. But if you did have a bad day, just remember my name is Jared Red. Our first stop is going to be Hotel Windsor. It's about an hour and 10 away. Be Hotel Windsor, Elizabeth Street, Rendezvous, then we'll finish off at the Savoy, all right? If you want to get off at any of them, go for it. But, yeah, thank you very much, guys. Hey, I had a bunch of ballerinas on last week. Gee, they kept me on my toes. I can't stop. All right, let's
go. YMCA. It's not just you know. YMCA. Young man, let the